Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Grad Slam. Thank you so much for coming. It is wonderful to have you here, and this is a fantastic turnout. So I'm just really thrilled to see all of you here tonight. And thank you for coming and supporting our graduate students and postdocs. So my name is Carol Ginetti. I'm the Vice Provost for Graduate and Postdoctoral Programs. And it is my great pleasure to bring you Grad Slam, which is our campus-wide competition for the best three-minute research talk by a graduate student or a postdoc. And this model was directly imported from the beautiful state of California in the USA, where Grad Slam has been part of the graduate programs at the University of California since 2013. And it's just such a fun, wonderful opportunity for everybody to really take a step back and appreciate the fantastic researchers that we have on our campus, as well as the amazing research that is going on. So I think it's just something that you're really going to enjoy. And I especially wanted to say thank you for our fabulous presenters who really went out of their way to put this together to be able to present it to you tonight. So in preparation for this event, the Office of Graduate and Postdoctoral Programs put on a whole series of workshops and also provided one-on-one coaching, made that available to the competitors so that they can hone their talk to the greatest degree possible. And so we had a total of more than 30 people that were participating in all of those run-up activities, and of those, 16 presented presentations in the semifinal round, and of those 16, 10 are here for you today in the finals. So the competitors are going to be going against each other for three different prizes. The grand prize is $1,000. The runner-up will receive a prize of $500. And the People's Choice Award is $400. So you are the people in People's Choice, okay? Each and every one of you has been given a ballot. If you don't have a ballot, raise your hand now. Okay, can we have a ballot down here, please? So each and every one of you has a ballot, and after you have heard all 10 talks, you can vote for the one that you think gave the best presentation. Okay, and then we will take this back and this will determine who gets the People's Choice Award. So one rule, you must see all 10 talks in order to submit a ballot. You can't just see the first talk, vote for the person and leave, okay? You have to see, we've seen people do that in the past. We have to see all 10 talks. Okay, the grand prize and the runner-up are actually going to be chosen based on scores determined by our panel of prestigious judges. Okay, note that the talks are not judged based on the research itself. This is not who's doing the best research, whatever that is. It's who is giving the best presentation. Okay, so there's a difference there. You can have somebody curing blindness and give a terrible presentation, and you can have somebody doing work on 13th century French literature and give a fantastic presentation, right? It's not about the research, it's about the presentation. And so these are the criteria that the judges will be scoring the talks on: clarity, organization, delivery, the use of visual aids, the extent to which the topic and its significance is communicated in language appropriate to an intelligent but non-specialist audience, in other words, you, okay? And okay? How well the presenters articulate why the project matters. And then there's something that's, a little bit harder to, put your finger on, but it's that magical quality of engagement. So did the speaker spark your intellectual curiosity and really make you want to learn more? In addition, each of the talks will be carefully timed by our timekeeper, Mr. Ashik Rafi, and he will be timing each talk. They have 3 minutes to deliver their talk. At the end of 3 minutes, a bell will ring. And after that, if the person continues to finish their talk, they will be rapidly losing points. And so those points will be deducted from their overall score. So at this point, it is my pleasure to introduce our panel of judges, our Senior Director of Professional and Executive Programs, Renee Dugan. Our Director of the Engineering Design Studio, Matthew Carrao. And our Associate Vice Chancellor of External Relations, Martin Bugua. At the end of each talk, the judges will be filling out their scorecards, and at that point, I will have some dialogue with the presenters. And then once they're done, they will be looking at me, we'll be making eye contact, so I know that they're done, okay? And then we'll move on to the next talk. But if you have questions for these presenters, make a note of it, because at the very end, after all 10 presentations are over, we will ask all of the presenters to come up on stage and open up the floor for Q&A. So make sure that you write down those questions and keep them in mind, because you're going to have the opportunity to engage with these researchers yourself. Okay, there we go. Since you couldn't see them because they're sitting down here in the front. Okay, and finally, please silence your mobile phones. This is really important because we don't want anybody's phone throwing any of our presenters off their game, right? So please take a minute to do that. The various presentations will be put into this order, going top to bottom, left to right. And basically, it's reverse alphabetical order based on first name. So that's how we determine the order of the talks. Okay, I think that that is it. You're not here to listen to me, you're here to listen to them. So we will move forward with our very first talk, which is by Zaid Khan, and it's entitled Slam Bus, a Stopless Autonomous Modular Bus System. Is it working?
Can you guys hear me? Has to be super close, I think.
Okay, hi guys. Let me start by asking you a question. How many of you actually took the bus to get here today? Wow. Why not? It's super environmentally friendly. It's much cheaper on your wallet. It saves you the hassle of road rage and gives you time to do something else while you're getting here. And it saves you a lot of space on the road, so it solves congestion while you're doing that. Why didn't you take the bus? Because it's so slow. It takes forever to get you from where you want to get to where you want to get. So what if I told you there is a bus service that takes you from your origin bus stop to your destination bus stop at the speed of a car without stopping at any other bus stop in the middle? Probably that'd get you to think twice about driving, right? The issue is, you say, hold on, doesn't a bus have to stop at every bus stop so that people can get on and get off? Not anymore. Welcome to the world of autonomous modular vehicles. These are self-driving bus pods that have already been pilot tested in Dubai. They can split and join while traveling so that passengers can internally transfer from one module to another based on where they have to go. My research is using these vehicles to envision a bus service that doesn't need to stop at bus stops. How, you may ask? Well, let me tell you. When a bus is approaching a stop, all the passengers who want to get off move to the back module. That back module detaches from the rest of the bus, goes and stops at the bus stop, lets all the people get out, and the main bus just carries on its way without stopping. Meanwhile, there is a module that detached from the previous bus that is waiting at the stop to board the people who want to get on at that bus stop. When the bus passes, when the main bus passes, it speeds up and catches up with that bus and attaches to it without having it slow down. Essentially, the main bus has bypassed the bus stop, delegating the boarding and alighting of the passengers to these supplementary modules while not losing any time stopping at that bus stop. And the result, very conveniently for today's competition, is called Slam Bus, a stopless autonomous modular bus service. Our results show that Slam Bus can reduce the travel time of commuters on a single bus line by around 25%, thus making public transport a much more attractive option for commuters. And we're not done there. Now I'm working on extending this to a citywide level with coordinating bus lines that transfer you from one bus route to another by means of interchanging modules, so that when you want to shift from one route to another, you don't even have to get off the bus to move to another bus. The future of public transport, ladies and gentlemen, is a seamless bus service that takes you from any point A to any other point B in the city without having to stop, without having to get off at any other bus stop. This is a key step towards the congestion-free, sustainable, eco-friendly city of the future. Thank you very much.
Wait, stay up here, Zaid. Yeah.
I hope I don't get dock points for that. Yes, sorry.
Okay, so well, thank you very much for that wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
So let me first ask you this. What country do you call home?
Can you guess? Anybody? Pakistan, Zindabad.
All right. Wonderful. Yep. How long have you been in the UAE?
That's a very complicated question. The answer could be anywhere between 3 years and 1 month. Uh-huh. So I'm going to go with 3 years just to.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I keep shifting between the UAE and Pakistan, thanks to my wonderful advisor who lets me do that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Thank you.
Uh-huh. And why did you choose to come to NYU Abu Dhabi?
There's a multitude of reasons. One of them was a great advisor. One of them was being closer to home. One of them was a Muslim country. And the pay package doesn't hurt, I think.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. So did you have a lot of experience with slow buses when you were growing up and going to school, going to college?
Unfortunately, the buses in Lahore are not at the level where you'd even want to take them, even if disregarding the slow factor. Uh-huh. So I had experience with slow buses in Boston and in New York and in Abu Dhabi.
Uh-huh.
So yeah, uh-huh. Pretty a lot of experience with slow buses.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So are there any of these prototypes that are currently in use already?
So they have been prototyped in the sense that there are physical units that are sort of proving the fact that these can operate. They haven't been deployed in a large-scale operation as yet.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Are any of those in the UAE?
Yeah, so in Dubai. So this was pilot tested in Dubai in 2019 or something. They had two pods, which isn't really enough to make full use of the operation that we're envisioning. But it's a start.
Uh-huh. Have they had people actually riding around in them?
Yes.
Have you done that? Have you been one of the people?
No, I have not. Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid has.
Oh, really?
But,
All right.
But yeah, uh-huh. They have had people riding around in them. None of them crashed so far, as far as we know.
Uh-huh.
They didn't slam into anything yet.
Uh-huh. And if given the opportunity, would you be one of those people to
absolutely.
Try it out? Absolutely.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely.
You're brave.
If I'm working on it, I might as well
give it a try. You don't think you'd feel a little bit woozy or something in an autonomous...
Don't you feel woozy when there's a rash driver, human driver driving?
I do. It's true. Yeah. It's true. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
All right, our second presentation is by Wael Adrabo. Malaria, an old foe thriving on steroids.
Hi, everyone. A mosquito fossil dated millions of years ago. An Egyptian king ruled Egypt 4,000 years ago. And the remains of a human who passed away during the Roman Empire. What is common between all of them? A microscopic organism that was found in their body. This microscopic organism is the culprit behind one of the oldest diseases that mankind have ever had to face, malaria. Malaria is transmitted to us by mosquitoes. The organism makes its way to the blood, where it invades the red blood cells, and it can eventually make its way to the brain, blocking the blood supply to the brain and causing death. 95% of the deaths related to malaria is in Africa. Every 2 minutes, a child passes away from malaria. And that is why we went to Africa, because one specific reason, not all the children die from malaria, and most importantly, not all the children feel or fall sick when they are infected by the disease. Typically, once the organism gets inside the bloodstream and invades the red blood cells, our immune system inside our bodies responds by organizing its lines of defenses. It has a front line that attacks the organism and attacks the invaded red blood cells, and another lines of defense that would try to reorganize and regroup the front lines of defense. When we looked at the children who fell sick in Africa from the disease, we found out that these children, they release specific chemicals. These specific chemicals, not only they regroup the front lines of defense against the disease and against the organism, but also it compromises the front lines, making these children more vulnerable to the disease and more vulnerable for more parasites and more of these organisms to invade more red blood cells. However, when we looked at the children that did not fall sick of the disease, we realized that they don't release these chemicals in their bloodstream, making their immune system and their immune response, the front lines, much more stronger, and they respond much better to the organism that's invaded the red blood cells. And that is why future treatments against the disease, it has to look into not just fighting the organism, but also the way we respond to the organism. And that is how we can bring a brighter future to these children in Africa. And with that, thank you very much.
Wow, very wonderful work. So nice to know that you're doing this. So tell me what country you call home.
Egypt.
Yes. Okay. I just came back from Egypt. I was there last week. So I did. It's
awesome.
A wonderful place. Yeah. So so tell me, you're a postdoctoral associate. Where did you do your doctorate?
Here.
Yes.
All right.
Very good. And so what brought you to NYU Abu Dhabi initially?
So eventually, initially I came to the UAE. I was working in the UAE and I decided to do my Abu Dhabi, where I looked up Dr. Yusuf Dabur. I looked at the research and I got really interested.
Uh-huh.
And I decided to start education one more time.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, take it from there.
Uh-huh.
I did my PhD and
And so do you do field work in Africa yourself?
Yes. Me and my colleagues. This takes it's definitely more than one man show. All my colleagues in the lab, we have collaborators. Africa, it's a huge team behind us in Africa.
And so when you go, do you always go to the same place or do you move around? Do you find that there's different geographical
different villages.
Differences?
So we visit, we arrive at the capital, and then from the capital, we drive to different villages where these children they live, and we go, we set up camps in their villages and where we can try to
Does this fall under the rubric of what's sometimes called precision medicine?
Absolutely, because now we have treatment that looking into fighting the organism. This is not specific to how every child would respond to the organism when that organism start invading the red blood cells.
Uh-huh.
So for us, the way this revelation is that we have to take into account these chemicals that are being released. Imagine with me, you would have fighting the organism and a complementary treatment that's blocking these chemicals with caution because these chemicals, they have different roles. They play different roles in the body.
Yeah.
So imagine it's complementing each other. You block these chemicals in a way that doesn't harm the body, but also enables the immune system, and you have a complementary drug that fights the organism. So that would make it much more efficient. And it would these chemicals, the levels of these chemicals, it changes from one child to another.
Well, fantastic work. Best of luck to you.
Thank you so much.
Okay, our next talk is by Wijud Awad.
Is it?
Making stronger materials by cracking the secrets of the Mari nut.
I don't get music. So, when was the last time you've ordered a package from Amazon or Talabat for it to arrive looking like this? Even though you've clearly told them to handle it with care. Now, this could be because during transportation, your package was, you know, stacked up under a bunch of other packages and it just couldn't handle its weight. It could also be because the person who was supposed to deliver it to you dropped it on the way and then the packaging just couldn't handle the impact and, you know, it ended up looking like this. So, Theoretically speaking, we can use stronger materials. So we can, you know, package it up in a box of steel. We could use rubber to, you know, to absorb the impact. But the problem with that is you are going to be using something that's a lot heavier than your standard packaging material. So what does that mean? It means that the few bucks that you spend to ship something will balloon up to a few hundreds, if not thousands, of dollars. Now, imagine if I were to tell you that the solution to all of our problems lies within a nut. And nut here is not an acronym for something fancy, it's just the one that grows on trees, literally a nut. Now, what's special about this nut is, okay, so before we move on to the nut, imagine this. If I were to hand you a pistachio nut, you could easily crush it with one hand. It takes about 250 newtons to do so, so it's quite easy to do. But if I were to give you a walnut, which is three times as strong, you would need a nutcracker for it. Now, this particular nut that I found, and it's found in Australia and nowhere else in the world, so it's pretty unique, can hold up to 2,500 newtons. So it's 10 times as strong as a pistachio. Not only that, but a chainsaw can't even make a dent in it. Wow. So we're talking about this little fellow over here. So trying to figure out what makes this nut so strong is the fundamental question I'm trying to answer with my research. To be able to do so, I have a fancy lab with some really specialized equipment that's able to do so. What we were able to find is the key point of this is layers. So we have different layers that have different functions. We have the outer layer, which is hard like a walnut. We have this spongy layer that's able to absorb the shock like a cushion. And then finally, we have a fiber network that's like a trampoline. It's able to just push back that force without affecting it. What does this mean? You're probably wondering, is this girl nuts? Why is she still talking about nuts? So this is the point where we translate this into real-life application, and it's my job to do so, using state-of-the-art equipment like 3D printers, which basically means that we design things through computers and then allow it to be printed into 3D models, and we use those for different purposes. So not only will the next time you order a glass vase off of Amazon be arriving safely to your place, we're here to protect the things that matter the most to all of us. We're able to create helmets for children's to protect their heads when they're biking, and armors for soldiers to, you know, protect them from shrapnel. So if you can imagine it, we can create it and protect it. Thank you.
One more. Let's see here. Okay. Good. Thanks. So, well, thank you very much for that wonderful presentation. And tell me what country you call home.
Well, I was born here, but I'm originally from Egypt.
Uh-huh. That's an interesting statement, right?
It's a bit unintuitive.
Yeah, it gets complicated. So did you spend most of your life in the UAE or in Egypt, or going back and forth between the two?
Most of it was in the UAE.
And where did you do your undergraduate work?
In the UAE. The answer to the majority of the question is going to be the UAE.
Okay. Sounds good. Well, I'll change topic then for you. So here's a question that immediately came to me. Was that you with a chainsaw?
Yes. I've been trying to crack it using different methods, including breaking a couple of blades. Just no one let the research department know about that.
Wow, that's something. So how did you first figure out that this particular nut was the one that had this kind of, you know, density and strength?
So basically, my supervisor was on a trip to Australia, and then he heard about this nut that's so strong that the only way that predators can get to it is through the seed dispersal hole. And us being material scientists, we're like, we need to figure out why. And then we didn't know it was going to be that strong and that it's going to be that difficult to characterize, but it is what it is, and, you know, we struck gold.
So you consider yourself a material scientist?
Yes.
Yes, fantastic. I mean, I think it's just amazing the materials that people use. And one of the things that I've noticed from the people I've known in materials is just the way that they take the natural world and are able to then convert it into these remarkable products. And so is that what you're hoping to do when you're looking forward in terms of how you want to spend your life?
Yes, I mean, nature has inspiration for a lot of things, not just materials, but yeah, pretty much.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, we have a lot to learn from it. It spent like thousands, if not millions of years perfecting its designs.
Uh-huh.
So yeah.
That's a good point. Yeah, good, good. One last question. Tell me something about you that your advisor doesn't know.
Something he doesn't know, that I probably broke two blades. In the research department,
okay.
Yeah.
So you're the one. Okay, we got it. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, our next speaker today is Rafet Mahmoud on income and terrorism.
Okay, let me tell you about a charming couple of the 21st century. The war on terror wedged the war on poverty in the early 2000s. And since then, they have been striving together to alleviate poverty to make this world a safer place. But hold on, how did this marriage happen? Soon after the 9/11 attacks, a narrative came into limelight that presented low-income countries as breeding grounds for terrorism. And this narrative gained momentum over time and space, resulting in an alliance between the war on terror and the war on poverty. Now, this alliance had implications. On one hand, governments invested heavily in poverty alleviation programs for countering terrorism, but on the other hand, it also created stereotypes about poor people and nations by linking them with terrorism. Developed nations started imagining poor countries as a collection of people with violent tendencies who are fighting over a few pennies with each other and are living in primitive conditions. So narratives have implications. But how well-grounded is this link between poverty and terrorism? The research so far is preliminary on this subject and does not offer very conclusive theory or evidence. And this is where my research comes in. I begin by formalizing why income matters for terrorism. So when resources of a country increase, terrorists have a bigger cake to snatch and have more resources to mobilize recruits. But at the same time, government also has more resources to capture terrorists. Also, opportunity cost of terrorism increases. If I can earn a lot in formal labor market, why invest my time in terrorism? Given these dynamics, the theoretical framework suggests that the relationship between income and terrorism is non-linear. Next, I look data from 179 countries for around three decades and find that when income increases, terrorism increases. So contrary to popular belief, increasing income levels are not associated with decreasing levels of terrorism. My research suggests that instead of using poverty alleviation as a counterterrorism strategy, the policymakers may use counterterrorism strategies with poverty alleviation in order to address this heightened risk of terrorism. Next in my research, I would look at other determinants of terrorism to find the true drivers behind the phenomena, because unless we know about the drivers, we cannot design efficient counterterrorism policies. But for now, if someone next casually remarks in front of you, well, poverty breeds terrorism, you may tell them, research shows otherwise. Yes, help me bust the myth and break the stereotypes. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rafet.
Yep.
So tell me where you're from originally.
Pakistan.
From Pakistan. And you're a postdoctoral associate in econ.
Yes.
Where did you do your doctoral studies?
In economics from Australia.
From Australia, yeah. Which university?
University of Western Australia.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I did see that nut there. So I could recognize it.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. That sounds good. What drove you to apply for a job as a postdoc at NYU Abu Dhabi? What attracted you here?
So the environment, the research environment, and the fact that you don't have to work with it. So in econ, it's different than it is in natural sciences. You don't have to work with anyone. You are an independent researcher, and you can work on any topic that you like. So I like the independence that
uh-huh.
came with the research environment.
Yeah, yeah. When I hear that there's a really strong group of postdocs that collaborate sometimes and work together and form community. So that's really wonderful. So what kind of factors do you think you're planning to look at in the future when you're looking at the relationship, or where were the causes of terrorism then?
So in my research, I've looked at the I was talking about poverty alleviation, but I don't focus here in my research as a counterterrorism strategy. But earlier in my research, I've looked at drone strikes, US drone strikes as a counterterrorism strategy to see whether they are effective in countering terrorism. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, I found that even they are not effective in countering terrorism. They are mm-hmm. kind of counterproductive. They result in an increase in terrorism and extremism. So in future, I think I'll look at like the political systems, state fragility, and like these kind of factors that are thought to matter for terrorism, but we need further like deeper research to find whether they actually matter or not.
Mm-hmm. So it sounds like your work is very interdisciplinary. I mean, you say, we have postdoctoral associate in economics, but it sounds like you're more than a narrowly defined economist.
Yeah.
How do you think of yourself in terms of your own sort of academic profile?
Yeah, so it's like I call myself a political economist.
Okay.
That's how I'll classify me. So my topics are from political science, and uh-huh. I try to apply methods from economics, so it's a combination.
Fantastic. We have so much really amazing interdisciplinary work on this campus. And so here's a great example of it. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, our next talk is by Isaac Sarnoff. Blazar boosted dark matter detection. A new vocabulary word.
Now, electrons, protons, and neutrons were only very recently discovered. And the discovery of electrons accounts for all of the technology that we're seeing here today, including your phone to your computer. Protons and neutrons together account for everything from new cancer treatments to nuclear bombs. But all of these together are less than a quarter of all of the mass in the universe. And if something like electrons that is so little of the world that you can't even see its slice on this map was able to give me the power to call my mom from halfway around the world, imagine what can be done when we find the other three quarters of the world. Now, if finding it was easy, then we would have done it by now. And unfortunately, we only currently know three things about dark matter. There's a lot of it, it's hard to find, and it's harder to measure. So, in order to do it, we have built some of the most complicated machines in the world. This machine, the detector called Xenon in Gran Sasso, Italy, uses 1/3 of a year's global supply of xenon. It is buried a mile deep beneath a mountain to reduce the background noise from regular radiation and other interference at the surface. And it still isn't enough. We still have not been able to find dark matter using this detector. One possible problem is that light dark matter may not have enough energy to produce the signals we need. So what we really need is a dark matter accelerator. But how can we accelerate something we can't see or touch? And that's where nature steps in. Blazars are a potential accelerator for dark matter. Basically, galaxies can shoot protons out from the supermassive black holes at the center. I'm talking black holes between 1 million and 1 billion times the size of our sun. And they can shoot these protons out at extremely high speeds. We hope that these protons can then accelerate, hit the dark matter surrounding the galaxy, and travel the millions of light years to Earth, where they will have enough energy that we can detect them. And so we are hopeful that some of the most powerful objects in our universe may be the key to unraveling one of its deepest mysteries. Thank you.
That's fascinating stuff. So tell us where you're from originally.
I'm from Washington, D.C.
Uh-huh. And what attracted you to NYU Abu Dhabi?
I really liked the amount of time with the professors. When I came out to visit, I was just blown away at the level of interaction.
Uh-huh. Good. That's what we like to hear. That's what we like to hear. Yeah, I'm not surprised. So it's really interesting for you to hear about this. Are there particular black holes that you are sort of targeting to be able to do this acceleration?
Yes. So we are looking at specifically blazars, which means that the black hole has to have a jet, and the jet has to be pointing at us.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, it would be accelerating these out some other direction, and we might never see it.
Uh-huh.
And it has to be very well characterized. So the one we're looking at specifically is called TXS-0506.
Uh-huh. How far away is it?
Far.
Very far. farther than I could ever imagine, I'm sure. Yeah. Okay. And have you been to this place to
TXS-0506?
Yeah. No,
oh.
No, to Z. You had all that time with your professors. I figured you were on.
You know, the travel budget here is good, but not that good.
Yeah.
Yes, I have. I went and I worked for about a month at Xenon over the summer,
uh-huh.
Helping manage the detector and basically fix problems as they came up.
Uh-huh. And what was that experience like?
It was really fun.
Uh-huh. So there are people just from NYU Abu Dhabi there, or were you part of a big research group?
No, as I say, it's an enormous amount of Xenon, and so it's actually a collaboration of close to 100 people from more than a dozen universities around the world.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. So part of a big global group of researchers doing this.
Yep.
Yeah. Fantastic. Well, I'm so glad you've had this experience, and I look forward to hearing about how you're able to identify all that black matter in the future, so dark matter in the future. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, our next talk is by Maria Al-Handawi, Make It Rain with Cloud Seeding.
It is predicted that 30 years from now, the amount of fresh water present on our planet will severely decrease. And this will cause more than 50% of the population to lose access to fresh water. In fact, this is a world map 20 years from now where all the regions highlighted in red are going to be classified as severe stressed regions. And this includes the United Arab Emirates. And just as an example, in the state of California alone, more than 700 trillion liters of water have been lost in the past few years. And the majority of that water was found in one of the biggest lakes in California that now is completely dried up. It is also predicted that 20 years from now, the Dead Sea, which is one of the most attractive tourist places in Jordan, will cease to exist. This problem is called one water crisis, and it's one of the most severe and biggest problems that my generation is currently facing. The issue with water crisis is we cannot physically create more water, so we have to rely on the water that is present on our planet. And how can we try to decrease the severity of water crisis? I believe one way to do so is to harness the water that is surrounding us, but not directly available to us. And the secret lies in fog. So there's tremendous amount of water locked in the atmosphere in the form of fog. And fog can form in various regions around the world. So it's widely accessible to the population, and it's 100% drinkable. But the trick is converting that water in fog to the liquid state. It may seem complicated, but this actually has been done millions of years ago, not by us humans, instead by nature, where there are many plants, animals, and insects that have adapted to extract that water from fog and drink it right away. So if we can learn from these natural systems, we can apply the same concept in our community to alleviate water crisis. However, it's important to mention that despite these systems being promising, it doesn't mean that they can supply an entire city with water. And this is why, for the first time in the United Arab Emirates and the Middle East, I've discovered the plant called Tamarax aphelia that can harvest tremendous amount of water, more than any natural system out there. And the mechanism and the way it does it is completely new and never discovered from before until now. And the way the plant does it is very simple. It deposits salts on the surface of its branches. And no, it's not salt that we use to season our food with. It's super salt that acts as a magnet, capturing all the water molecules from the surrounding and condensing them on the surface of the branch for the plant to drink from. So this is just a video to show you the super salt in action, collecting and harvesting water for the plant. So how can we use this to combat water scarcity? Well, the secret lies in the super salt itself. We can easily make it in the lab, we can harvest it from the plant, and all we have to do next is to take that salt, spray it into the clouds where there is a lot of water, the water will be collected, will fall to the ground in the form of rain, and like that, we will supply an entire population in a huge region with water. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you. That was a really interesting talk. So tell me where you're from.
I'm from Syria, but I was raised and born in UAE.
Okay. Yeah. Good. So you've been here a long time. Where did you go to college? Which university did you go to for your bachelor's?
So I also did it here from University of Georgia, but I studied pharmacy instead of material science and chemistry.
Uh-huh. And how did you make that switch from pharmacy to
It was really difficult, but I had many people who supported me, so I made it there eventually.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, this is really fantastic work. How did you find out about this particular plant?
Oh, wow. I just drove randomly in the desert and I found the plant.
Yeah.
But it's quite interesting because in the UAE, it's 80% a desert.
Right.
But the amount of water locked in the atmosphere is a lot. Almost all of us every day experience high humidity levels. It condenses on our hair. It makes our hair on the phones and makes our hair worse.
Yeah.
So I thought to myself that really there has to be a system out there that makes use of that water in the atmosphere. And there are in the UAE, because there's no water in the land and there's a lot of water in the air.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amazing. This is just an amazing talk. You know, I saw another talk in Santa Barbara when I was doing Grad Slam of someone that was looking at fog and the power of fog to make landscapes that are resistant to wildfires.
Oh, yeah.
So something very similar, you know, kind of a similar type of a statement, but because the plants do absorb so much water.
Yeah. I mean, really this process of generating rain is used in the UAE, but they use simple salts, like the one we use for food. But this salt is really, really special. It can harvest water at very low humidity. You don't need too much water in the air to start and collect it. So it's really, really very efficient.
Yeah, okay. All right, well, thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Okay, and our next presenter is Hanin Al-Surari on the language of touch.
Have you ever ordered a white shirt online and you had to return it back simply because you received a blue one instead? Very unlikely. Now, how many times you ordered a shirt online and you had to return it back because you did not like how it feels on your skin? Sometimes we forget that visuals are not enough, and how things feel is an important part of our experience. It would be wonderful, for example, to have this technology that can enable simulated touch. Simulated touch is valuable not only for online shopping, but for many other applications. For example, simulated touch is needed for doctors performing robotic surgery, where they need to feel the texture of different organs inside the patient body. The term we use to describe technologies that can enable simulated perceivable touch is called haptics. It is evident that haptic technology is lagging way behind visual technology. Part of the reason haptic is hard to develop is that it is hard to describe. Our language does not have enough vocabulary for touch as much as for vision, and describing one's haptic experience becomes extremely challenging. Look at these different levels of blue. Not only we can see the difference, but we can describe it. Blue, light blue, and dark blue. But what about describing the level of softness of a teddy bear, cotton towels, and a furry cat? Do you realize what is the issue here? We have no accurate way of describing how things feel. Not only that, but our haptic experience is extremely subjective, and it varies from one person to another. Now, my graduate research was focused to solve this problem. How can we evaluate our haptic experience accurately to better help haptic technology designers? My answer is by tapping into our brains. How can this help? Well, our thoughts are a reflection of what we really feel. And if our language fails us, our brains will not. My graduate research developed a framework to evaluate the haptic experience using brain electrical signals. We bring people to the lab, and we ask them, for example, to rub their hands with a soft ball and a crunchy paper while their brain signals are being measured. We take this data, and we train machine learning models to learn neural patterns that can be directly associated to object softness. We no longer need to ask people about their haptic experience. Instead, we measure the activity of their brains. I hope you realize that we cannot build reliable haptic technology until we agree on a touch language. And this is what we're exactly trying to do. Our work is foundational in creating a neural dictionary for touch that can be used by engineers to develop amazing haptic technologies, such as a tablet that will let you know accurately how the shirt in your shopping cart is going to feel. Thank you.
Thank you, Hanin. Yeah, so tell us where you're from originally.
I'm originally from Jordan.
From Jordan, and yes. How long have you been in the United Arab Emirates?
Well, my parents moved from Jordan to UAE, Sharjah, in 1998. Uh-huh. So I've done my studies here, uh-huh. and my undergrad here, but now my parents are back to Jordan, uh-huh. but I'm still here.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Yeah. Sounds good. So this is really, you know, really fascinating stuff. So it seems to me like you're an electrical engineer.
Yes.
But it seems like you're also doing neuroscience.
Yes, actually, my research is very multidisciplinary. So we have, like, we deal with the neuroscience part, and then you have the signal processing, and then you have the haptic technology on the other side, and then machine learning. So it's, many fields together.
Uh-huh. Yes. Uh-huh. So it must have taken you a long time to really master all of that. Or do you mostly work, or do you think of it as being more collaborative, where you do one part of it, and then your teammates do others?
Well, I think I had to learn most of that. Uh-huh. I did some EEG work. EEG is a short term for the electrical brain signals that we can measure in my undergrad. So I had some background about it. But during my study here, that I had to learn more about haptics. I had to learn more about machine learning. So it took a while until I was able to integrate the different fields together into one piece, yes. Uh-huh.
So when you think about, you've heard about all kinds of haptic technologies that are in development. What's your favorite one? Is it feeling the fabric on the tablet?
Yeah, I hope that we can reach to this one day. We have this tablet in the lab. You cannot still feel like the texture of different fabrics, because you will need a technology that can translate the fabric sensation into an actual, actuation on the tablet. But this tablet can help you feel some simple, sensations, like guitar strings, for example. Uh-huh. Yeah, it can do that.
Yeah, fascinating. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next up we have Christopher Holder. Where am I? Teaching robots to build mental maps.
Okay, is my mic on? Okay, good evening. Is anyone falling asleep yet? Maybe you could go outside, get a coffee. Please don't. My talk's going to be very interesting, so please stay and listen. But close your eyes. Visualize the process of going to get that coffee. You'd leave your chair, you'd walk to the aisle, up the stairs, out through the door, over to the coffee table. In your mind, you can visualize it clearly. You don't need to check Google Maps, because when you come into this room today, even if you've never been here before, your eyes subconsciously will have been capturing thousands of images of everything that you see. They'll have been passing that through the neural connections in your brain and building a kind of a mental map of the layout of the area around you that allows you to position yourself within the room. You know where you are, and you know where other people and other things are. Now, imagine you don't even need to get up from your seat to get that coffee, because you've got a robot helper. You just turn to him and say, "Oi, robot, go get me a coffee," and off he goes. But in order to do that, he needs to know where the coffee is, but he also needs to know where he is right now in order to plan a route from A to B. Indoors, GPS generally doesn't work very well, so this is quite a challenging problem. Or maybe he could just kind of have a coffee machine built into his torso, Futurama style, I don't know. But this leads me to the main question of my research. Can we teach robots to build these kind of mental maps like we humans do? Can they learn to map the layout of a space and position themselves within it? Now, fortunately, in order to answer this question, I have my own robot helper. This is Husky. He's big and yellow, and he's got four wheels. Unfortunately, he can't get me a coffee yet. And without the right software, he's also kind of a bit stupid. Now, Husky doesn't have eyes, but he has a camera. He doesn't have a brain, but he has a computer. And fortunately for Husky, in the 1940s, neuroscientists came up with a concept called a neural network. It was meant initially as a way to study and understand the connections within the human mind. But then people have built on it since, and now we know that we can build complex AI models that kind of approximate the way that humans learn, enabling computers to learn. So we built a neural network AI system, and we used it to teach Husky to build a mental map. We put him in a small apartment, allowed him roam around randomly around this small apartment, taking photos. We can see some examples of his wonderful photography skills here. In all, he captured 30,000 photos. In this top-down view, every red spot represents one of the photos he took, so we have complete coverage of the whole room. Now, all of these 30,000 images, we fed them into our AI system. We repeated it multiple dozens and dozens of times, and with each image, the neural network tweaked its parameters ever so slightly, a tiny bit, inching and inching towards our ultimate goal of a system where we can take an image, and then we get an output that tells us exactly where that image was taken. So what does this mean for Husky? Well, let's say he's over one side of the room and he sees an image, and this image contains a bookshelf and a lamp. So he says, aha, I know where this is. And then he's able to successfully navigate from point to point through the room. This could be used for a robot navigating warehouses, factories, hospitals, maybe even one day, something as mundane as a robot butler that can get you a coffee. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Christopher. So where are you? Where do you come from?
I'm originally from the United Kingdom.
Uh-huh. And how long have you been in the UAE?
I've been in the UAE, it's 3 years now.
3 years. And where did you do your doctorate?
My doctorate was at Durham University in England.
Uh-huh. And so you just saw a job ad that was a good fit for you in terms of your postdoc, or how did you make that transition?
I saw a job ad. The salary was good, and I hate rain.
Uh-huh. Sounds good. Well, it seems like you came to a good place if you hate rain, although, you know, it could be that will change over time as technologies develop. So how did you get interested in working with these kinds of robots? And are you more interested in developing the technologies, or are you more interested in figuring out, I guess they're related to each other, obviously, but figuring out how to, you know, frame it so that it can make its mental map? I mean, they're kind of two different levels, right?
Yeah, well, my work is in computer vision, so this is perception, teaching computers how to see things. My PhD was in autonomous driving.
Okay.
So, you know, cars that need people in. But there's a lot of work in robotics as well, which is how I got into this.
Uh-huh.
I've done a lot of work with drones, but the legal situation in the UAE makes it difficult to work with drones now, so I'm mostly working with these kind of ground-based robots now, teaching them how to understand their environment and navigate safely.
Uh-huh. And how is this different from a vacuum, like a little Roomba vacuum that I might have in
my living room? Robot vacuum cleaners, they have a lot of sensors for detecting obstacles, so they can kind of randomly move around the room, or maybe they're following a set pattern, sort of up, down, up, down, up, down, to make sure they get the whole floor, but they don't know where they are. They're just following a pattern or a random route. When they see an obstacle, they turn around and go a different way. Uh-huh. So when we were initially capturing the images that we used to build that mental map, that's how our robot was moving.
Mm-hmm.
But then once we'd actually taught it to build that mental map, it was able to, you know, if it sees a picture of a bed, and it could say, aha, I know where I am in the room because I've seen this before.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next up, Ayub Ghalia, and his talk is entitled Cell Banking at a Paper Cut.
Thanks. You hear me? Many of us lost loved ones to cancer. It's a devastating feeling that I probably share with many of you here today. We've lost close to 100 million people to cancer in the last decade. That is the population of Australia, Canada, and the Gulf region combined. All gone. That is because cancer is a complex disease, is a shapeshifter Discovering a new drug for it or bringing a new one to market typically costs $2 billion and takes an average of 14 years of research. There are split into three stages. First is drug discovery, where we test our hypothesis. Then we move to preclinical testing, where testing is performed on cells that we grow in a lab environment. And then we move to animal testing. And after that, we then test on humans. Preclinical testing costs hundreds of millions of dollars and takes an average of 3 to 6 years of research. And the cells that we grow in a lab environment do not really represent how tumors grow in a real human body. And that's why we move to animal testing, which is cruel and also does not represent us, does not represent the human body. So my goal in this research is to redefine preclinical testing by providing robust testing models. We call them tumors models on paper. These models, we have a vision to eliminate animal testing with them. These are 3D tumor models that we grow in a paper and we preserve for many years for immediate use for testing. And the innovation here is simply substituting these bulky three-dimensional storage tubes with these two-dimensional papers. Now, if you take these papers, 200 of them, and you stack them in this cryobox that you see here, this is equivalent to 200 of these storage volumes. Now, you can imagine with me the sustainability impact this could have on giant biobanks. I'm talking about biobanks that handle hundreds of millions of samples that are stored in these tubes. There is 99% reduction in plastic tubes, reagents, labor, and the energy to maintain these samples at minus 196 degrees for years. Now I want you to imagine with me a future for you, you and me, for all of us, where aside from having a Facebook account, we have a biobook account, little booklet that you see here. Each paper holding the most vital cells that we have in our body. And who knows, maybe it could save a life. Thank you.
All right, well, thank you, Ayub. So tell us where you're from.
I'm from Morocco.
From Morocco?
Yeah.
And how long have you been in the UAE?
Well, in and out. Well, I came here first time in 2001.
Uh-huh.
Left to do my university studies. Some of them were done in US, some of them were done in Cyprus.
Uh-huh.
Traveled a bit, came back to the UAE, left and traveled a bit again, worked in other places of the world, and then came back to the UAE. So I kind of have this back and forth love story with the UAE.
Yeah, I understand that, yeah. So this is just really fascinating research that you're involved in here. So how did you think, or your whoever thought initially, to use paper for this kind of storage? What was it that kind of prompted that thought? What kind of prompted that aha moment?
So this idea comes from 2011, an idea that my PhD advisor had in a lab because they were struggling with space, probably. So they said, why don't we store cells on paper? And then this paper, this research grew in our lab. A lot of people contributed to this research. And then we discovered that we can grow 3D structures within this paper platform. And these papers, they resemble more how cells grow inside our body than a normal flask or a normal petri dish that usually scientists use. And we started building on it. And when I came, and then I started, my job is also to advance this technology to have it more versatile for testing, but also to take on the commercialization aspect of it and try to see how we can take an idea that is in a lab environment that is published, the work is published and everywhere, and make it reach and make it have a real impact on in the UAE in particular, in the world in general. So this is my mission in the lab.
Fantastic. Okay, good luck. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, and then our final talk of the evening is by Alam Saj on improving PCR testing.
Am I audible?
There is this object, which over the past couple of years has turned out to be an absolute nightmare to me, while at the same time it managed to force itself to be a very regular part of my life. I'd like to show you what that is. The swab of a PCR test or COVID test. I get terrified every time I'm approached with this to be taken the sample from, but got a man up. Let's say I somehow managed to get that done with. Is it over yet? Nope. Then there is the long wait for the test result to come out. And during this period, I'm restricted and refrain from engaging even in my daily routine, like meeting my friends, spending time with my family, and so on. Now, have you ever wondered what causes it to take so long for this test result to come out? Let me tell you why that is. In a regular RT-PCR test, after the sample is collected, millions of copies of the sample has to be created before being able to perform any diagnosis. And this process on a regular basis takes from a few hours to days. In addition, it requires special chemicals which add to the cost, and it also requires trained professional. Now, what if I told you there is an alternate technique that rules out all these requirements? Let me introduce you to detection of the virus using single molecule fluorescence microscope. Before we proceed any further, at least some of you guys might be wondering, what is this guy doing here with an umbrella after the storm? Like, the COVID is almost over, right? Well, this technique is not exclusive to COVID-19 virus. It can be easily deployed for the detection of any other virus, but today I'll be using COVID as a template because, you know, it's been the star among the viruses lately, the star. So let's get back to the sample itself. The sample that we're looking at is a sample made of molecules, which comprises of both healthy molecules and virus molecules. And each one of these molecules are different from each other, and meaning that they have their own unique fingerprint. So in order to detect this virus, what we do is we introduce a bait into the sample. And this bait is loaded with the information about the virus that is to be detected. So when it enters the sample, it finds the virus and gets itself attached to it. After this, we introduce something called fluorescent molecules into the sample. And these fluorescent molecules are specially designed such that they can only bind itself to a bait which has acquired its target. Otherwise, they just flow out. So having that, you know what fluorescent molecules do, or fluorescent materials, just like a fluorescent jacket or fluorescent gel, they glow in the dark. These molecules glow too, but they're not visible to human eyes because they glow in a molecular level. So we introduce a sample to a single molecule fluorescence microscope. Now all we have to do is look at the sample through the microscope. If it glows, the virus is present. If it doesn't, it doesn't. Thus, we achieve the detection of the virus from the very sample. No copies required, no additional chemicals, no waiting time, just a microscope to look at the glowing virus. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So tell us your story. Where are you from and how did you get here?
I was born and raised here. That's how it starts. And then I studied all my life. I did my bachelor's in LA in UAE University. Uh-huh. And now I'm doing my PhD here in NYU Abu Dhabi.
Uh-huh. So in physics?
In physics, yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. So after my bachelor's, I was, like, towards the end of the bachelor's, that's when I actually started thinking about the future. I was like, what should I actually do my, like, graduate studies in? Uh-huh. And I thought it would be better to do it in a field which has direct applications, like, in our lives. Mm-hmm. And I found biophysics to be a very suitable field for that.
Uh-huh. So there, that kind of answers my question. My next question was about interdisciplinarity, because when I look at this talk, I don't associate it with physics. I associate it with like biomedical science or something along those lines.
Yeah, fluorescent microscopy, that's where the physics part comes in.
So I see.
The microscopy that we use is something called total internal reflection microscope, and that's like based on like physics principles, so uh-huh. Yeah. Uh-huh. But I do understand that it's very heavy on biology too.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So, yeah, you answered one of my questions already, which is the COVID question. And it's like, well, wait a minute, aren't we like, aren't we over COVID? Are we over COVID? I don't know. But, you know, but it's interesting to hear that this is also can be used. So just for viruses, or do you see that this is a technique
that could be
used? Generally
for viruses, because viruses are made up of like DNAs, uh-huh. and that's the building block of it. Uh-huh. So this detection technique relies on using these DNA molecules. So that's the molecules that I was talking about. Uh-huh. We use these DNA molecules, and the way they are capable of forming double strands, that's the technique that we use to detect the virus, but like it gets a bit more technical if I go further from here.
Uh-huh. Okay, yeah. Well, wonderful. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, that brings us to the end of our presentations, which means that the calculation of the scores will begin. So everybody who has been here that has a ballot, this is your moment to weigh in on people's choice. So we will have people walking up and down the aisle and picking up the ballots. So please pass them to the center. Pass them to the center of the room. And we'll have someone come down and pick them up so that we can calculate those scores. Who's getting them here? Yeah. Okay, Yvette will be picking them up. She's coming on down. While that is happening, I would like to invite all of our presenters up on stage. So please come on up and join us. Scoot over a little. I think everybody can fit. Okay, here they are. Big round of applause. Woo! Okay, so the floor is open for Q&A because I don't want to be in the way. I'm going to step down here. Who has a question for one of these presenters? Yes, over in the back over there. Yes. You, yes. Yes.
So I actually had a question for Zed. So fascinating research. I was curious about the method for parking. So as you mentioned, if someone wants to get off at a particular spot, all they have to do is go back at the last coach, and that detaches and then stops at the assigned place. My only question is, in terms of inclusivity, if someone has, let's say, a leg injury or some other like problem of that nature, they might take greater amount of time to get to the back coach before it detaches, and that might cause the entire bus to slow down rather than just the back coach. So it kind of like seems it in that situation defeats the purpose.
No, you're absolutely right. Thank you for that great question. Very tough question, so maybe not thank you. But I'll tell you the honest truth, which is that so far, all the research that has taken place on autonomous modular buses has assumed that there is an upper limit to the time that people take to transfer between modules internally, right? Those upper limits for short distance applications like regular buses are unrealistic for paratransit. But then again, paratransit in most developed cities is a separate service that is offered usually by the government to people who have a status as, you know, being disabled. So those are usually specialized vehicles that are routed in a customized way based on where the person needs to go. So those passengers typically do not use public transit as, I mean, I'm talking about severely mobility impaired passengers, people on a wheelchair and so on. People with, you know, people who are old or walking slow or, you know, have an injury or something, you could increase the distance between bus stops in order to get there enough time to have them make that transfer. But that there's a trade-off to that in terms of the amount of walking that people have to do to access those bus stops. So there's a definite trade-off between accessibility and speed, which we're looking to explore more in the future.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Okay, next question. Yes, green shirt.
Question regarding the... Hey. Hi, regarding cloud seeding, very interesting topic. But my question is actually regarding the salts that you're using is going to end up where? Because imagine if you have like a green area and you're going to have to do cloud seeding a couple of times, you're going to have the salt is going to end up on the soil, and that's going to cause higher salt concentration in the soil, and that's going to affect so many things. So is that something we should be worried about?
So this is the issue with the current methods. Hello? Yeah. So this is the issue with the current methods, like what people are now using for cloud seeding. They use sodium chloride, which we put on food, but you need large quantities of it because it's not very efficient at all. But with our salt, we need extremely, extremely small quantities, so it's not going to affect the environment. Plus, more importantly, is that this salt exists in nature, so it's environmental friendly, so we can really use it in very small quantities without having any effect on the environment. Thank you.
Okay, Sehamuddin. Yeah. There's the microphone right here.
Thank you. Sticking still to the salt. You didn't tell us the composition of this salt. What kind of compound is that, number one? And number two, since you found it in the UAE, is this in certain areas, i.e. depends on the soil that the salt is probably, the plant is producing from, and whether there are studies that you are thinking about to do as to what kind of grounds you can use to basically produce these kind of things?
So the salt is composed of at least 8 different types of salts all mixed together. And one of the major components is sodium chloride, so it makes up like around 60%, but the other 40% is other minerals, you know, mixed together that makes the salt very, very efficient. And the region where the salt is forming, it's in a localized region, it's the Sabha. So it's the region where the sea makes contact with the land, so it's the coastline. And of course, depending on where you go along the coastline, the salt composition could differ. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to scan the entire region, entire UAE, find plants that secrete salts, you know, near the Sabha, away from the Sabha, and see in terms of composition and concentration, what is the salt made of? And who knows, we might even find more efficient salt than the one that I found. But so far, the one I found is efficient enough.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, congratulations to all of you. Really wonderful presentation. So my question is for Rafat. So I'm just wondering about how terrorism is defined in the databases that you looked at, because that's a very complex term, and there might be, you know, various definitions depending on who you ask. And I'm just wondering how it affects the correlations that you showed.
Okay, thank you so much. So terrorism, the definition that I use, you're right that there are multiple definitions, and the definition that I use is kind of a gold standard in terrorism literature. So the act must be intentional, use of force must be involved in that, and must be by a non-state actor. So state terrorism is not included in that. It needs to have a goal, an economic, political, religious, or social goal, and also it needs to have an intent to convey a message to a broader audience beyond the immediate victim. And also, it cannot be classified as a legitimate act of warfare. So, like, the Civil War acts are excluded from the data set. I hope it answers. Thank you.
There's a question in the far back, and then one over here.
I have a question for Alam. My question is that when we were doing the regular PCR tests, we saw many cases of having false positives. If you are using your method, which is extremely sensitive on a molecular level, how do you rule out those false positives?
So in a regular PCR test, basically they use these kind of fluorescent molecules too, but they look at it in bulk quantities. So that is why they have to multiply it. Normally, we're not able to see the fluorescence in a single molecule using the normal techniques. That's why they have to increase the quantity. So when the intensity overcomes a certain threshold, then we're able to see it. So when we do it at a molecular level too, when it comes to sensitivity, it might probably be like very similar to the PCR test, like the probability of false positive might be similar to that, but again, what we are like focusing on here is cutting down the additional cost and the time, additional time that's involved in the process of multiplying. Does that answer?
Yeah. Thank you.
Question over here.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for your talks. This is a question for Dr. Glia about the paper chips in the context of maybe drug testing and what you think about personalized medicine and how that would be applied for your technology and with drug testing.
Thank you for your question. First, I would like to ask you, when you want to picture a scientist, the first image or the first couple of images that comes to mind, I don't want to stereotype, but a microscope and petri dish and probably some cells under. And these cells, they come from somewhere. I work with probably sometimes billions of them in a single day. How many of me are there in the world? Just one. No, I'm just. But there are many people that are using cells also around the world. And some of these cells are used heavily for drug testing. So now these cells, they grow in the lab in a two-dimensional way. That does not mimic really how they grow in real life. By growing them in paper, we are trying to get as close as possible to how they exist inside their normal or natural physiological aspect. Now, drug testing is the fact that you can grow these tumors in forms of arrays and columns, thousands of them, will allow you or will give you the opportunity to digitize drug testing. And one important aspect about drug testing is that tens of thousands of molecules, one of them works. So there's always this testing back and forth going on. Now, by digitizing drug testing, you can really cut down on the preclinical testing time, and with that, probably save lives. Thank you.
I have a question.
Yeah. Go for it.
I have a question for Jude, actually. When you're presenting, did you taste the nut?
Unfortunately, it's a distant cousin of the eucalyptus, so I would not recommend doing that.
Yeah, I was going to ask something similar. Could you make edible packaging?
Edible packaging. Biodegradable, yes. Edible, I wouldn't recommend. Uh-huh. I did some work on macadamias, which are a lot better to eat.
Yeah.
To snack on after you crush them.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that can help with the waste problem. Yeah. Okay, I think there are some more over kind of on this side. Go ahead.
Hello, thank you. My question is to Sir Isaac. First of all, two questions, sorry. Is it blazer or blazar, and why is it called dark matter?
So it's blazar. It's a play on the word quasar. And it is called dark matter because it doesn't emit light, I think is the main reason. It doesn't really interact with most things in a way that we see. But it's not like actually dark.
Some other ones on this side? I think she's got a mic, right?
Yeah. Okay, so this is a question for the work on cloud seeding. So it's pretty cool that you found an alternative for the current salts used. So now that you have your prototype, I guess, what are the next steps for it?
What we would like to do is to try and, we're going to ship some of their salts, some of our salts to them, but they're going to put it, on their aircraft and just spray around and test how efficient it is. So it's in that process.
Red shirt, yes. Please come in.
My question is for Dr. Christopher. So since you spoke about coffee, it intrigued me a lot. I just want to know if this technology is being incorporated at any of the cafes across UAE. So just.
Not that I know of, but if they want to pay me, then I'd be happy to work with them.
Okay, one last question and then we'll wrap up. Go ahead.
So about blazers, why do you use xenon? And another question, so why do you think that the blazers will accelerate dark matter? And do you think that dark matter is particles in your model?
The first one, I'll start with that because I can answer that more easily. We use xenon because it scintillates and ionizes easily. So there's very little background with it. And when it gets hit, it emits a little bit of light and sometimes charge that we can then detect. Can you remind me what the second and third question were? So the second question is, why do we think blazars will emit dark matter? And the third is, do I think dark matter is a particle? I'll start with the third. Is I think so, yes, but there are a lot of dark matter theories that do not think so, in which case we won't be able to detect it. Back to the second question, we believe that if we can detect it, it must be able to interact with regular matter in some way other than gravitationally, and therefore we look for that because that's where we can look. And if it can interact with the xenon through nuclear collisions, then it can hopefully also interact with the protons in the blazar jets through the same process.
Okay, I think the scores are in, so let's have a round of applause for all of our presenters. You guys did great. Please come have a seat. All right, well, before we announce the scores, of course, an event like this doesn't just sort of happen suddenly without anything behind the scenes, and so I just want to take a minute to really thank a whole lot of people who made this possible, because this is really a community effort, and we are so grateful to our many colleagues from across the university who partnered with us to make this event possible. So you can see some of them, these other offices listed here, and I'd like a special round of applause for our judges, because they really worked hard. Competition, and it's not easy to do that particular job. So, many, many, many thanks. And and thanks to all of our colleagues from the Office of External Relations, our audiovisual group, and our postdocs and PhD students, and all of the faculty who also helped with working with all of these amazing postgraduates to be able to bring these presentations to you today. Dr. Robbie Nadler was a special consultant from UC Santa Barbara, and he's back in Santa Barbara, so unfortunately he's not here to see this event, but he was also very much engaged in this whole process with the training part. So, and then finally, I just really would like everybody from the GPPO, the Graduate and Postdoctoral Programs Office, to step forward so that we can say thank you to all of you. Come on, you guys. So these people that you see here, this is my amazing staff that really do so much for all of us in terms of the Graduate and Postdoctoral Programs Office. And over here, I especially wanted to thank Carl Kalinkowitz and Ross Fleming, who have done untold amounts of work throughout this to make this competition possible. So, okay. The envelopes are in. Let's see. We will start by announcing the winner of the People's Choice Award. We'll go to Wael Abdrabul. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah. You can just see it. Yeah. Okay. You can stay up here if you want. Stay up here for photos and such. Okay, then our second place winner, $500, goes to Zayed Khan. Congratulations. Sorry. Yeah. 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 Okay. All right. Very good. All right, and my hands are trembling with the first place here. So our grand prize winner of the 2022 Grad Slammy is Mariah Al-Hamdawi. Congratulations. In my opinion, they're all winners. And so thanks to all of you for your wonderful presentations, for everything you did, for sharing your research with us, and making us understand what a fantastic institution this is. And so thanks. And please join us for a reception. We have all kinds of food out there. Use the time to ask more questions of these wonderful scholars. And just enjoy.